Welcome to Part 8 of Test-Driven Development in Unity. So far, we've created a player class to manage player health internally, and a heart container class to display the player health on the user interface. In this video, we'll be using C# built-in implementation of the observer pattern to connect these two classes together. But before we get started, let's talk about the observer pattern. The observer pattern is a design pattern in which an object, called the subject, maintains a list of its dependents, called observers, and notifies them automatically of any state changes. It enables you to define dynamic relationships between objects that can be changed at runtime. This pattern is most commonly used to implement user interfaces. It makes displaying things like ammunition, inventories, and of course, health bars much easier. We'll be using the observer pattern to create a relationship between the heart container and the player, so it can react when the player's health changes. Let's get into the code. The heart container should be notified whenever the player's health changes, so let's give the player class a couple events. We'll call this first one healed. The event keyword is syntactic sugar that'll allow us to take advantage of C# built-in implementation of the observer pattern. Objects in our system will be able to subscribe to the healed event and will be notified whenever it's invoked. Event handler is a built-in delegate that we can provide custom arguments to. Let's do that now. We'll create a nested class called healed event args. It'll need to implement event args so our event handler can take advantage of it. For now, the only argument we need to provide is the amount healed. Let's give it a private setter and initialize it on the constructor. Now, we can define healed event args as the type our event handler will use for its arguments. This will make it so that each method that subscribes to the healed event will need to have a healed event args argument in its signature, which introduces a nice bit of type safety. Now our healed event is ready to be raised whenever the player is healed. Let's switch over to player tests and create a test to drive the addition of that logic. First, we'll create a nested class called the healed event and a test called raises event on heal. Working our way from the bottom, let's add an assert that verifies that the healed event is raised by the player class whenever its heal method is invoked. Amount will store the value provided by the event args, which in this case will be 0. We'll initialize it to -1, so we know whether or not the event is actually raised. Next, we'll need to actually instantiate a player and call its heal method. Finally, let's subscribe to our player's healed event using a lambda expression. This is where we'll set amount's value, using the args passed in from the event. You'll recall that the args must be an instance of our custom healed event args class, which exposes a property called amount. Alright, let's run the test. And of course, it fails. Now, we can switch back over to player and implement this. Making this test pass will be easy. All we need to do is invoke healed within the body of the heal method, passing in this instance of player and a new instance of healed event arg. For now, we'll give its constructor the value that was passed into heal, and we also need to null check it in case there are no subscribers. Alright, let's run that test again. And there you have it. We're almost ready to move on to the damaged event, but first we need to handle overhealing. Any amount that results from overhealing shouldn't be passed into the healed event. If a player has max health, then the value passed into healed should always be 0. Let's switch back over to player tests and create a test to push us forward. We'll call this test overhealing is ignored. And we'll copy and paste the code from our previous test. The difference, however, is that player will be instantiated with a current health and max health of 1. Then we'll pass 1 into its heal method. In other words, we're trying to heal a player that's already at max health. Let's run that test. And it fails, because we expected overhealing to be ignored. We expected 0, but check it out, the actual value is 1. Again, this will be an easy fix. Let's hop back on over to player. Since we're already truncating overhealing on current health using math's min function, all we need to do is store the new health value in its own variable. We'll call it new health. And use the difference between new health and current health for health event args. Alright, rerun the tests. And like I said, easy enough. Now we can move on to the damaged event. It'll follow the same principle, so we can actually move through this pretty quickly. Again, we'll use C# event keyword and event handler delegate to craft our damaged event. We want to expose at least one custom argument, so let's create another nested class that implements event args. Following the same naming convention, we'll call it damaged event args. For now, it just needs to pass in the amount, so we'll create a property with a private setter and initialize it on the constructor. With this in place, we can define the argument type of the damaged event's event handler. Now, to drive the process forward, we'll switch over to player tests and create a nested class called the damaged event. Within this class, we'll create a new test called RaisesEventOnDamage. It'll contain a local variable called amount that'll store the value that is passed in on the event. We'll assert that its value is equal to 0. Then, we'll need to instantiate a new player and call damage. Finally, we'll subscribe a lambda to the player's damaged event that'll update the value of amount using the damaged event args. Okay, run the test. And as expected, it fails. So let's switch back to player. Within the damage method body, we'll do a null check on damaged. Then, if it's not null, we'll invoke it, passing in this instance of player and a new instance of damaged event args. Everything passes, so let's create our last test of the entire series. Much like last time, we'll call it Overkill is Ignored. Copy the body of the previous test. This time, player will have 0 health, and will pass 1 into damage, and the test fails for the reason we expected. Amount should be 0 rather than 1. So let's switch back to player, store the new health value into its own variable, and then pass the difference between new health and current health for damaged event args. Rerun the tests, and again, there you have it. Everything is finally in place, so we can make all the necessary connections and button this series up. We'll create these connections in the app class, which serves as the preloader for our game. Currently, it creates a heart container using images that are set in the editor, and allows the user to manipulate heart container with the up and down arrows. Let's add a property to hold an instance of our player, and instantiate it on the start method. We'll count each hit point as one heart piece, which is why we're passing in 20 on player's constructor for current health and max health. There are 5 hearts in the scene, giving us 20 heart pieces to work with. Now we can make the heart container subscribe to the player's healed and damaged events using lambda expressions. On healed, the heart container will replenish itself using the healed event args. And on damaged, the heart container will deplete itself using the damaged event args. We'll finish this off by modifying the update method to call heal on player when the up arrow is pressed, and damage on player when the down arrow is pressed. Now, let's test her out. I'll press the down arrow a couple of times, and now the up arrow. And we can test all sorts of values, so let's change the amount to 5. Now we'll do some heals, and cause some damage. Great, everything works as expected. Isn't it amazing how much code we were able to write and test without ever running our game? This is a huge time saver, especially on large projects where startup takes a while, or in instances where testing the code you're working on requires a lot of setup. Not only did we gain productivity, but following the test-driven development process sort of informed the way we wrote our code, too. As a result, our player health and heart container implementations are completely decoupled. Oh, and we have a test suite, too. Can't forget that. You see, test-driven development is about more than just tests. But we'll talk about that in another video. For now, it's time to wrap this series up. I hope it was helpful and informative. If you enjoyed it, please leave a like. And if you have any questions, feel free to leave a comment. And if you'd like more videos like this one, please don't forget to subscribe with notifications on. See you in the next video.